hear me?
Yes.
You can? In the back, you can hear me? How about now?
Tim?
Can you hear me? No, doesn't matter about you. Wasn't talking to you. So Art Frankenthal has done quite a bit of arranging for Carolina Brass. He is he's a very dear friend of ours, and actually when I was living in New York, he was my next door neighbor. He's probably not really a household name, but for musicians, in particular for brass players, he really is. The Canadian Brass, for instance, that he's done a lot of arranging for them as well. We've got at least one or two other tunes by Art on this program. The next piece we're going to play, another arrangement done for us, this family, everybody knows family, you know, there's a guy by the name of Jack Gale. And if you've been to Broadway and seen a Broadway show in the last 40 to 50 years, he did that for several decades. Good chance you heard Jack playing trombone. So he played on, spent his career on Broadway and teaching at Manhattan, is either Manhattan or the Manhattan School of Music, I think it was Manhattan School of Music, teaching theory and composition. Great guy, just passed away about a year and a half, 2 years ago, something like that. We're very fortunate to have gotten a number of pieces from him. So we're going to do this arrangement that he did, the Phantom of the Opera, and hope you enjoy it. Before we do that, we'll just take a moment to introduce the group.
Yeah, man, great job.
I'm trying.
Thank you.
completely different. Boyce, William Boyce, we were talking about household names earlier, not necessarily a household name even for musicians, William Boyce, not like Johann Sebastian Bach, although they had a lot in common. They were both organists, they were both Baroque composers, and they both composed in an older style. Bach was sort of famous for continuing to compose in the Baroque style when it was sort of going out of fashion. In fact, when Bach died in 1750, that we marked that as the end of the Baroque era. Well, Boyce did not get that memo. He continued to compose Baroque music until his death in 1779. He actually he knew Bach, he knew Handel, he actually met Mozart, so he was right on that transition to classical, to the classical era. His music is not that well known, but lately a couple of things have kind of thrust it into the public eye a little bit more. One of his pieces was performed at the coronation of King Charles, the most recent King Charles. Were there other King Charles? I don't know. I don't keep up with it. But one of his pieces was played at the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. And before that, probably even more importantly, this piece was arranged for Carolina Brandt. voluntary in B-flat.
Oh, in B-flat.
Thank you.
this next tune well, Crossing Berkeley Ferry is an original composition. What you've heard so far, yes, everything so far has been an arrangement. I mean, you probably know this already. You know, the piece already existed. Someone made it work for us, for instance. This next tune, original composition, Crossing Berkeley Ferry by Elam Ray Sprinkle. So it was originally written based on, I believe it was a poem by Walt Whitman. I looked this up a while back and Phil Sanders talking about this.
So far, so good.
So far, so good, yeah. Most of what we say is true. and what isn't true, is it? But it's an interesting poem. The poem is about, the Brooklyn Ferry. Basically, it talks about we're really kind of all the same. You know, we get up, we have breakfast or not. We go to work. You know, we pay our dues. You know, we come home to our families, and it's sort of for that celebrating that kind of average life, so to speak. And then also maybe it's we call it the American dream. And he portrayed this piece, it's portrayed in a lyrical way. Now, this originally didn't have percussion, but clearly we have a percussionist. So we added that, we like that addition. So we hope you like our little arrangement of Crossing the Brooklyn Ferry. So here we go.
Thank you. throughout my music studies, I found it really interesting to learn that during his time, Bach wasn't considered the genius that we consider him now.
Kind of like us.
Right.
They just don't get it.
So in the last year of his life, 1749, the year before the Baroque era ended, Bach decided to showcase his brilliance with an intellectual work called The Art of the Fugue. And this is a collection of 14 fugues and four canons. And what's very interesting about this is that he didn't specify any instrumentation. He might have even thought of brass motet. We're going to be playing the ninth fugue called Contrapuntus 9. And this piece is one of the double fugues in it. So there's two fugue subjects that are interwoven throughout, and they're over the top of each other, they're backwards, they're upside down. So make sure to get out your notebook, take notes, there'll be a quiz at the end. This is Johann Sebastian Bach's Contrapuntus 9.
wrote in a really similar fashion. But interestingly enough, although Bach might have envisioned these pieces to be kind of architecture, I had a teacher describe architecture and sound, meaning it kind of fits for any instrument, kind of like Garrett was saying that even a brass quintet might have been something he had in mind. Well, Gabriel actually wrote music for brass instruments to be performed. It's some of the oldest written music that we have for our instruments. And most, as a church organist, most of Gabriel's music was written for the church to be performed in all of the church rafters and throughout the cathedral. And so that's what we're going to imitate here for you today by spreading out in what's known as the antiphonal pattern. And so I'm going to make my way to this seat right here in the middle. But I want to, maybe close your eyes and imagine that you're in a big cathedral surrounded by all of these harmonious sounds that work in a kind of imitative way, similar to what you just heard with the counterpoint in the last piece we played, that the same kind of phrase is going to pass itself through the room and hopefully we'll all end together. So this is Canzone Personale number 4 by Gabriel.
And we always like to point out, if you like the first three, you're going to love this one.
Instruments were tools of the devil. together. And despite that, he played guitar and then organ and then cornet and became a trumpet player. Educated man, he passed a teacher's exam to teach at a very high level at age 19. He became a trumpeter on the road, became a band leader in his early 20s. He traveled around and played a lot. He started composing almost immediately, and he had quick success with this tune, St. Louis Blues. But he had already published lots of pieces by then. He became one of the most published composers of that era. In fact, he ended up with a publishing company with his office in Times Square, overlooking Times Square. So he was a quite successful businessman with all this. He was even featured in 1949 on the Ed Sullivan Show, playing trumpet and playing this composition, St. Louis Blues. It's been recorded by probably hundreds of people, but very famous recordings by Louis Armstrong, Bessie Smith, Glenn Miller Orchestra, Tommy Dorsey, Louis Armstrong recorded it. So this is a well-known piece, and he is considered the father of the blues, partially because he took this Delta-style blues from Alabama, and he sort of changed the form of it just slightly, making the repeats a little bit different, and sort of codified what came after it. So, Father of the Blues, W.C. Handy, this is St. Louis Blues.
Thank you.
piece, the little fanfare I'm playing, was not in your program. So immediately following the program, if you just line up and leave a little bit of money for me. So that tune, it was the fanfare written by he actually wrote 122 of these. It's called Fanfare of Blossom. So he wrote 122 of the Blossom Stricken. That's the only one that survived. So who knows what the 121 will like. But based on having played number 122, I don't think I really want to play the previous 121. Because it goes up to the stratosphere, as you heard. That piece, you may be familiar with it, the fanfare. Who's heard CBS Sunday Morning? Those people, raise your hands. Those are all the people not in church on Sunday morning, by the way. I'm just joking. I've seen it too. Soon we went to the early church. He wrote that for Anton Weidinger. Very famous trumpet player at the time. Shortly after one of his performances, actually, he played the Reich of Fanfare. He was walking home through the lamp-lit streets, and he dropped dead of a heart attack. It doesn't really bode well for me. But that's what happened, so we'll see. And then followed that up with Trumpet Voluntary, Jeremiah Clark Voluntary. And that was often attributed to Henry Purcell incorrectly. It's actually Jeremiah Clark. So we're kind of on a mission to tell everybody, but nobody's really that interested. However, we think it's important. Our next tune, am I talking about this next tune?
I'm on
the Hoffman.
Okay,
we're
going.
Okay, so this next tune we're going to play,
it's also a fanfare.
Yeah, it's not a type of fanfare. So fanfare, tango, and fugetta on Hebrew themes. So what happened with this? Stanley Hoffman is a composer who we actually didn't know him. And it was about 15, maybe pushing 20 years ago. We've been together, we started this group in 1997. And most of the original members are still here. But we played several pieces with the Chapel Hill Community Chorus. They were celebrating some big event, like their 50th anniversary or 75th, something like that. So they hired us to play with the chorus. So they commissioned all this music. A lot of it was by a composer named Gwyneth Walker, who's written several pieces for us as well. She's more of a choral composer. But we played this concert, it was recorded, and then they sent it off to Shermer Music up in Boston to be published. And Stanley Hoffman was working for Shermer Music. So he contacted me and said, you know, I really love the recording. Can we use your recording with the music when we send it out throughout the country, advertising our music and our new publications, sending primarily to choral directors across the country. I said, yeah, sure, that's fine with us. And we got to talking, and turns out Stanley and I both went to New England Conservatory just at different times. I'd done my master's there, and he did his doctorate there after me. And I said, yeah, it sounded like he was a good composer based on our conversation. And I said, well, would you be interested in writing something for brass quintet? He said, yeah, I don't have anything for quintet, but sure, I'll write a piece for you. So that's how this piece came about. So we just it just kind of happened. So we commissioned him, and we wound up with this next tune. It's all in one sort of movement, so to speak, but it's there are sections here. The first is the fanfare, the soul of every living being shall bless your name. And then that goes into another section, when Israel went forth from Egypt. And it's written in a tango style. After that, it's a little fugetta, how goodly are your tents, O Jacob. And then it comes back around to a fanfare, a little more subdued, but very much like the beginning. So we hope you enjoy Stanley Hoffman's Fanfare and Tango and Fugetta on the Hebrew.
big peace line. It's really great to see familiar faces here and be part of making music in this really lovely space. So really appreciate being back and getting a chance to play a part of these guys. So thanks again for being here. The next piece on the program, I'm really glad I get to talk about it because it means a lot to me, actually. For as long as I can remember, my grandparents, I used to watch this the movie version of West Side Story with them all the time and became really familiar with this music. And so Leonard Bernstein's score is monumental. There's not a single note that seems misplaced or not without joy, really, in the writing. It's really fantastic music. And the story is like a retelling of Romeo and Juliet. So it's been in our sort of American popular culture for many, many years now. In fact, this movie was recently remade by Steven Spielberg, and it continues to see lots of productions and in different settings, like this one by Jack Gale, who comes up a lot in music for brass, especially this type. He put together, again, another kind of monumental version of this that contains many movements featuring a number of the tunes, even written in a way so that you can play them seamlessly. And it's kind of a tour de force for a brass quintet. And luckily enough, through knowing Jack Gale, the quintet was able to commission some movements that were not a part of this original suite, because there's so much fantastic music that's a part of West Side Story. And so we're going to add one of those at the end of this little set of music. So that is Maria Tonight. One Hand, One Heart, am I saying it right? And then the last one is G off of Krupke, which if you will hear a lot of shenanigans and fun from the group. So this is a real joy, it's a pleasure to be back here. This is Leonard Bernstein's selections from West Side Story by Jack H.
Thank you. Tim asked me to do a little something, and I played all kinds of hand drums from around the world for a long time, and so I thought I'd bring a pair of tabla that I played. Tabla are from North India. They're used both in the classical music and it's spilled over into the folk music and into pop music, and because it's all one world now, you can hear them all kinds of recordings in the Western world also. But if you go to study tabla, they teach you how to be a soloist. Not that there's a lot of tabla solo, but there are some very famous tabla players out there who do this. And I'm gonna show you the sounds. And usually I don't play this in a suit, especially not wearing black, because I have to use talcum powder, and I will not be all black by the end of this.
It's usually taken.
Well, I try to convince Tim to go all white. But they were not going for that. So tabla is collectively a name for both drums, even though the right hand drum by itself is also called tabla. Tabla means right hand, and bayan is left hand. So I guess if you're left handed, you're out of luck. But like I said, they're from India. The lower drum called bayan is made out of some sort of metal, used to be made out of clay. It's very heavy brass. The head is what's really interesting about it. So it's a three-layer thick head. It's a goat skin. What you see in the middle is the only full layer. This is a cutaway layer here. There's a cutaway layer on the side. And they load the head with a mixture of overcooked rice and powdered slag. Slag being the residue from iron ore smelting. You think, how in the world did they come up with that? Well, they did this a couple of thousand years ago. And what's interesting about it is that it causes a drum head to go from a non-harmonic sound into a harmonic sound. So the overtones align when you do that. So you can actually get pitches on this. And this one is very specifically tuned, but I'll play this one first. So this is the lower drum. And get my preparation here away from my hands. And they're not loud drums, but hopefully this you can hear in this hall, this low pitch. You can hear that, yes? So each sound is given a name. So if you're trying to teach it, you would say, just like if you have do, re, mi, this is go, or any G sound, go, ga, gi, ga, go, 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 go. And you can bend the pitch by either depressing or by gliding. Right? So then you have a dry sound, a cup. So you have go and ka. And ko can be ko, ka, ki, or ke. Any of those. On the right hand drum, this is the lowest pitch. It's here. This is called tune. But usually you play a harmonic. And by just like on a violin string, if you cut it in half, if you put your finger in the middle, you get an octave above it. Well, the same is true for this. So if this is the low sound, you get a harmonic by putting your finger at the edge of this. That's not quite a true octave. It's actually more like a seventh. But you have to do that with the same hand you're playing with. So you take your ring finger and put it at the edge here to get the harmonic. You have two. This note is called na. You also have one over here, which is called tin. So two, tin, na. If you have three, most basic harmonic sounds is an unusual one. It's also called ta like this. You've got dry sounds. You've got tete, you play in the middle. Red stroke. And you've got tere, tere, played in the full hand. And then you have combination sounds. So a ga with a de, with a te, becomes a de. Like de, te, de, te, de, na. You've got a tin with a ga is a de. So de, na, de, na. Diga, dina, teka, dina, dagina, diga, dina, na. Sound. If you were to go hear a tabla soloist, this is a recording of a harmonium, which is a keyboard instrument with reeds in it, much like a pump organ, old style pump organ here. And they play repeating melody. This one happens to be in 16 beats, which is called tintal or main cycle. And the tabla solo would play over this with cadences that coincide with the first note of the lahara. It's called a lahara in this usual tabla solo. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16.
Originally by Queen, probably.
heard this before. When did it come out? 70s? 80s?
I'm guessing 70s.
1970s. And someone we knew, well, it's an interesting story how this one came out. This was arranged for Carolina Brass. We were going to play a wedding in Charlotte. And the guy that was getting married was actually a very fine musician. He was heading up the Salvation Army organization for Carolinas, the music organization. And he's British, but he's actually back in England now. He was here for a few years. So he came over, and he just came over to get a wife. He came over here, met this married woman, got married, and went back to England. Took her and left. But he wanted this piece, and some interesting pieces, at their wedding. And he said, oh yeah, I know this great arranger over in Great Britain. Except he's got a friend of mine. You know, we'll do this arrangement for you. And that's how this piece came about. So we just had a great time playing. Gonna have a good time, right? So hope you enjoy this tune by Queen, Don't Stop Me Now.
Thank you.
thanks so much. One more tool left here. And what a, you have protons, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I haven't seen them actually, so I guess we did it right. Kept everything in order. Before I play this last tune, I'd just like to mention Dr. Johnson here, Dr. Dan Johnson. He's the one who brought us out here. Some of the faculty, if you don't know him, you should get to know him. Great guy. And we go way back. Dan and I were in school together at Newman Conservatory back in the day, and we actually played in a brass quintet together. We played tuba. I was still playing drums. And so it's great to get to see him. He brought us here, I think, I don't know, 10, 12 years ago. It was pre-pandemic, that's for sure. Anyway, it's great to be back here in UC Wilmington. I just want to, Dan, thank you for having us. We enjoyed this afternoon. We worked with some students that were here. We had a good time with that. We're very grateful for the opportunity to come back and be on the stage and play for you. So thanks again, Dan, and all the folks that the stage hands and so forth who made this possible. We greatly appreciate it. Thank you. So this last piece, just the closer walk, it is a, I'm walking a little too close apparently. It's basically a story, it's a funeral march. So someone's loved one has passed away, and so it's written in the New Orleans Dixieland style. So we're going to try to recapture that. And so there's this long, slow funeral march to the gravesite. And then you'll hear when we get there's an amen, prayer, an amen. And then there's a big celebration that their loved one has gone on to heaven. And then everybody's, just really celebrating that person's life. So that's the story behind Just a Closer Walk. So we hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Oh.